Hi, welcome to 10th Presbyterian Church. I'm delighted to introduce to you a new face to our community, Ms. Therese West, a violinist. She's originally from the Pittsburgh area and attended a PCA church there before going to Cleveland area to study violin. She's recently moved to Philadelphia to study violin with David Kim, who's the concertmaster of the Philadelphia Orchestra. So we're delighted to have her here. She's been attending 10th regularly, having moved here. I did want to say one word about the selections tonight. We're doing them in a different order than's listed in your bulletin. She'll play the Bach piece first, and then the three hymn arrangements will be done exactly in the opposite order that they're listed.
Thank you. Good evening. That's me switched on. Okay. That's good. Glad to see you this evening. All of us feeling very superior. And the color of ties is significant this evening. So that's all I'm going to say about that for the time being. Well, good that you're here for worship. And I'm going to read from Isaiah 66 these great words. Thus says the Lord, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. What is the house that you would build for me, and what is the place of my rest? All these things my hand has made, and so all these things came to be, declares the Lord. But this is the one to whom I will look, he who is humble and contrite in spirit and trembles at my word. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you this evening, and we're grateful that you stoop to listen to those who are humble, those who have seen themselves really as they are, and not as we would like to be. That you come, Lord, to the weak and the faint, and you come to those who are the nothings of this world, because you delight to raise up and exalt the last and make them first. We come this evening, Lord, and we come to cast ourselves upon you again and pray that you would please come and be with us in the sense that we feel you present. We ask this in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Amen. Let's remain standing as we go to the Lord in confession. You'll find our prayer of confession in your bulletin, and we'll read this together to God and then hear the gospel's assurance of pardon for our sins. So let's join together the prayer of confession. O Lord our God, no day of our lives passes that does not prove us guilty in your sight. Even our best efforts are as filthy rags before you. We ask you to forgive our sin, because he who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, that in Christ we might be fully pardoned and restored. Grant that by resting in his righteousness alone, we may hereafter walk in newness of life and run with endurance the race that is set before us, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And hear these words from Philippians 1:6. And I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ.
As you're turning in your Bibles to Song of Solomon, chapter 1, for our reading tonight, I need to make an announcement officially. The meeting of the congregation of 10th Presbyterian Church in Philadelphia, PA, is called for February 11th, 2018, after the 11 a.m. service, for the purpose of voting to dissolve our pastoral relationships with Dr. Bruce McDowell. This meeting will be held in the sanctuary. By order of the clerk, Dr. George K. McFarland. So we are reading from Song of Solomon, chapter 1. We'll be reading verses 1 through 7. And let's begin with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you again. We thank you again for the privilege that you've given to us, that we may come into your presence to worship you. Our desire, flowing out of love, is that we might come and express that to you. As we've just sung, we can't do it alone in our lips, nor even in our hearts, but rather we'd ask that our lives might be evidence of how much we adore you, how much we desire to know you, and how grateful we are for the freedom we have tonight of gathering to hear from you. So come, meet with your people. May your spirit fill our hearts, that as we hear from your word, we might hear your voice of love drawing us closer. For it is in and through the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Now reading. I am very dark, but lovely. O daughters of Jerusalem, like the tents of Kedar, like the curtains of Solomon. Do not gaze at me because I am dark, because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's sons were angry with me. They made me keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyard I've not kept. Tell me, you whom my soul loves, where you pasture your flock, where you make it lie down at noon. For why should I be like one who veils herself beside the flocks of your companions? If you do not know, O most beautiful among women, follow in the tracks of the flock and pasture your young goats beside the shepherd's tents.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Our great and gracious Heavenly Father, we now ask that as we offer back to you these tithes, that you would use them to advance your kingdom here in Philadelphia and in our hearts and to the ends of the earth. We pray that for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Take our Bibles and turn together to Songs, chapter 1, Song of Songs, chapter 1. And I remind us, or I tell you for the first time, that Song of Songs is the Holy of Holies in which we contemplate the love of loves. And that the song, in many ways, is the basis for some of our great hymns, like Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. The song speaks to the friends of the bridegroom, meaning our Lord Jesus. It makes sense to those whose senses are being renewed by the Holy Spirit. And so the physicality with which the language is abundant in this reminds us of our nature, our human nature, and our creatureliness. It reminds us that in our human nature and in our creatureliness, we seek perfection, but are intrinsically incomplete. We're not there yet. The grace of Christ both brings us back to Eden and moves us forward towards a great destination, final glory. Grace is the life-giving work of Christ by the Holy Spirit, whose great task it is to make us more like the Lord Jesus himself. As Thomas Aquinas puts it, the Holy Spirit makes those whom he has sent like the one who sent him, whose spirit he is, the Spirit of Christ. And the Holy Spirit's in the background of this book all the time. The focus or the foci of the book, the direction which it's pointing is to the bridegroom, this Adamic figure in the background whom we have not yet met in person in the book, and the bride, or the bride-to-be, we should say, who we've heard so far. And her desire is for the bridegroom, and the bridegroom is Christ, the bride is his church, his people, and the means by which he communicates is by his word and by his spirit. And we saw that lies behind that redundant expression in verse 2 when she asks him to approach her intimately by the kisses of his mouth. It's by the mouth the word is spoken and formed, and that the breath is breathed. And God communicates not only his knowledge and understanding to us by the word and by the spirit, he communicates his life to us by the word and by the spirit. He speaks life and breathes life into us by his word and by the spirit. And in 1 Corinthians 15, for example, the first man, Adam, was created a living being. The last Adam, Christ, became a life-giving spirit. And so the Adam-like figure that's in the background here in this book is Christ. We see him, first of all, at a natural level and then at a spiritual level, just as we begin to know ourselves at a natural level. We know ourselves as we are right at this moment this evening. We are very physical beings. We are fragile beings. We're going to die. These bodies will be laid to the dust. But that's not our destiny. Our destiny is to be spiritual beings. As the Apostle Paul says, it's not the spiritual that's first. The natural comes first, then the spiritual. And what is natural to us in the body now is a type of what will be in the spiritual body, or the psycho-spiritual body, the spiritual body that will be when we're in a state of glory. And so throughout this book, there is this longing in the heart of the bridegroom for the perfection of that final state, for the glory that is to come. Mike Allen, in one of his books called Sanctification, puts it like this: God fashioned this world for a still higher end, which we can and should call glory, meaning by that full maturity and completeness, and what the Bible sometimes calls perfection. Well, perfection is in the background. And tonight, as we come and pick up the story of our bride here, we find her saying here in verse 5 something about her own imperfection, the tension that exists between what she has in terms of her outward appearance and her inward nature. It appears that she was being taunted by her enemies. Her outward appearance, we're told, she puts it in these terms: "I am dark, very dark," she says. We find out exactly what she has in mind. Apparently, she had been taken by her mother's sons, who were angry with her. They made her keeper of the vineyards. They made her go out into the hot noonday sun. She becomes sunburned. And as she looks at her appearance, she looks like a worker woman, a woman from a lower caste, we might say, if it was in India. A lower form of social class, we might say, in our society. She looked rough, we might put it. She was not looking as perfect-skinned as the women who were in the royal court. And as she sees the entourage of the king in the distance, and she looks at these perfect women there, she feels imperfect in herself. And there are those who are taunting her about her sunburn, and they're taunting her about her appearance. And it's interesting the way that this has come about, as she refers indirectly to what happened. My mother's sons were angry with me. this idea that she's distancing herself from them. They're my mother's sons. They're angry. They made me do this. They forced me to adopt their priorities, to do what they wanted me to do. She reflects on this, that she did not choose this way that she is in, the situation that she is in. She confesses her own weakness, her own failure. My own vineyard, she says, I have not kept. There's a reflection there of the story of the Garden of Eden, the vineyard, paradise. She did not guard it. She has fallen just like everyone else is. She understands that. She understands that her fallen nature, as well as the fact that she had been forced, pushed by the crowd, by these mother's sons she refers to do what they wanted to do, to follow by their ideas, to live by their suggestions and with their pressure on her, she realizes that all of that has kept her, has left her the way she is. C.H. Spurgeon in his sermon says, this bride has a false impression of herself. Believers often have a false impression of themselves. They listen to the accusations of Satan. They listen to the accusations of their own conscience. They listen to the accusations of other people. As they look on at them who are underlining the imperfections, as it were, in their life. And if we listen to these voices, the voice of Satan, the voice of our own heart sometimes, and the disapproval of others, as we listen to these voices, we can lose our confidence. There's an element of introspection here, bordering on fear or insecurity and uncertainty. She's wondering whether she's worthy. She looks at this royal retinue. She wonders if she's worthy of this man that she loves and who loves her. This translates very easily into the life of the bride of Christ or the individual believer. We feel inadequate. When we're among the saints, sometimes God's people seem, there are some of God's people who seem very acutely holy and make us feel totally inadequate. She'd experienced hardship. She was not by nature part of the royal retinue. Her appearance was rough. Look at the way she puts it. She says it's like the tents of Kedar. These are the tents in which the people of Kedar lived. They were draped with black wool skins of goats for insulation from the Middle Eastern cold evenings. She appeared common, ordinary. The bride of Christ, the church, the individual believer, may often feel like this, appear like this. And there's a sense in which that's the fact. By nature, we do not belong to the royal family of heaven. By nature, we are not part of the royal retinue of the King of Kings. By nature, we are dead in trespasses and sins. The church of God doesn't always look nice from the outside. It looks rough. The bride of Christ, very often by schisms, rent asunder, by heresies oppressed. But you see, that isn't her whole view of herself. She says, I am very dark but lovely, O daughters of Jerusalem. She contrasts the sunburnt worker woman appearance with another aspect of her character. She contrasts the tents of Kedar with the curtains of Solomon. Now, the interesting thing about this is that the language here is important. The curtains of Solomon, what's she thinking about? Is she thinking about King Solomon? Or are we to think of the one who came along and said of himself, a greater than Solomon is among you? The name Solomon means peaceful. But the greater than Solomon is named Peace, the Prince of Peace. He is our peace. The original Solomon was noted for his wisdom. But the greater than Solomon is known as the power of God and the wisdom of God. He's the one who shares not only his wisdom, but his eternal peace and joy, along with the Father and the Spirit, to those who know him. This bride's beauty is hidden deep within. The curtains of Solomon were the curtains in the temple. The curtains in the temple hid the Holy of Holies. So she's contrasting this. Similarly, in the tabernacle, the curtains hid the Holy of Holies. If you looked at the tabernacle from the outside, the tabernacle was covered in the same kinds of skins. It looked ordinary. It looked common. But inside, there is this beautiful curtain that is put together, 4 inches thick, that stands in within the temple before the Holy of Holies. And that's what she's referring to here. Not only on the outside does she look like the tents of Kedar, but interiorly, she has been transformed by the power of God. She has another view of herself, dark but lovely. And that's a wonderful mystery, because it becomes clear that the bride's beauty is hidden deep within, a work of God creating the glory of the believer, which is hidden from the world. The world looks at the church. The world looks at the believer. And in the language of the Apostle John, it does not yet appear what we shall be. The world looks at the Christian and does not know the glory that will be revealed in us. The world looks at us and sees us dark, but God looks at us and sees us lovely in His eyes. The world does not yet see the day when there will be a manifestation of the children of God. This tension exists within the heart of the believer and within the church of God itself. You see the tension expressed by the Apostle Paul when he says to us, "Consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many of you were powerful. Not many of you were of noble birth. But God has chosen the foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even the things that are not, to bring to nothing the things that are, so that no human being might boast in His presence." This is what the church of God looks like. It's rough on the outside. The individual believer is often rough on the outside spiritually. But that is not the whole story. As Paul writes to the Corinthians, he says about these same people, "Because of Him you are in Christ Jesus, who has become to us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption." When you hear her story, her testimony, "I am dark but lovely. Don't gaze on me because I'm dark, because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's sons were angry with me." When you read her story, it reminds us of the believer's testing. Not only a tension in the believer's experience, but a testing in the believer's experience. The tests and temptations of life beneath the sun. We can say with the psalmist, "My sins are always before me." But we must never lose sight of the work He has begun in us. He has begun a good work in us. The tabernacle was covered with coarse skins, but inside there are expensive curtains. The believer on the outside may look like the tents of Kedar, but inside, the elegant and expensive curtains of Solomon. "We have this treasure," says Paul, "in jars of clay, so that the excellency of the power may be of God." So the bride teaches us, we who make up the bride to be the church, it teaches us to remember, I think, the humanity and the divinity of the church. The church is very, very human because we are human. Therefore, it is not perfect. Its organization isn't perfect. Its members aren't perfect. Its ministers aren't perfect. There is nothing perfect about the church on this side of the sun. The face of the church is the face of a sinner, said Martin Luther. And when we look at ourselves, very often, when we look at Christ's bride, the church, we want to say, as she does in verse 6, do not gaze at me. Stop looking, would you? Divert your gaze. Because what you see is an embarrassment to me. But don't leave it there. She describes the hostility that she received from her own kith and kin. It reminds us that love to Jesus is no security against hatred and animosity and envy and ill treatment from the world and sometimes even from within the church. Those who live near to Christ, brothers and sisters, are envied, maligned, and ill-treated. Samuel Rutherford, writing from prison in Aberdeen during the killing times in Scotland, as a Presbyterian minister, wrote letters to those on the outside. His letters were full of Song of Songs. And in one of his letters, he writes, those who would be with Christ must be with him, even when the rain is in Christ's face. And he goes on to say, the rain is in Christ's face in Scotland. And anybody that would be with him must have the rain on their face too. Now that means nothing to you, because your rain comes down vertically. Our rain comes at you horizontally. Well, as we look at this, as the story here, those who live closest to Jesus are most likely to lift to find themselves under the pressure of the world. We saw when we were looking at verse 2 that the first cry of the believer in Christ is that Christ would come to us by the Holy Spirit. We long to be filled with the Holy Spirit since he's the Spirit of Jesus. And there in verse 7, we find the church and the believer at prayer. That's what she's doing here. She's speaking to her beloved. Tell me, you whom my soul loves, where do you pasture your flock? Where do you make it lie down at noon? Why should I be like one who veils herself beside the flocks of your companions? She's saying, is there any good reason why I, who am your bride-to-be, should be hiding myself? She speaks from her heart. The heart of the believer is driven by her love for the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love. Or as Job puts it, oh, that I knew where I might find him. Or Mary of Bethany, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. And she falls at Jesus' feet because she loves him. Here the bride of Christ longs that her beauty might be established and grow and be fruitful and be seen, that people would see that she belonged to him. She wants to be fed. And feeding the sheep is the proper work of the shepherd. She wants her bridegroom, who is the shepherd, the good shepherd, the Lord our shepherd, the shepherd and overseer of our souls, the great shepherd of the sheep. She wants him to provide the green pastures that she needs to feed, to be nourished, to be brought back to health, as it were, and to be established. And you say, where are these green pastures where Christ feeds his flock? Surely the green pastures are the doctrines, the ordinances, all the commands and promises of Scripture. The Good Shepherd leads his flock the length and breadth of the Word of God in order that we might be fed by this Word, nourished by this Word, built up by this Word, established by this Word, grow by this Word. That's how he feeds his flock. That's why he says to his under-shepherds, feed the flock of God over which you have been made an overseer. It is because the flock of God need the Word of God as manna for their souls to establish them. Many a weary soul has stopped to rest where the Word of God is being taught and been nourished there. And you can see that she's given advice in verse 8. If you don't know most beautiful among women, follow in the tracks of the flock and pasture your young goats beside the temple, the shepherd's tents. If you want to get to Jesus, here's the advice. Don't try and find another way to him. Find where the people of God have been going all along and follow them. Find where the people of God nourish themselves and go with them. Take the way the saints have walked and walk with them. Follow the tracks of the flock and pasture your young ones there. Be with the people of God. Worship with the people of God. Learn from the people of God. And you will be nourished in your soul. And that's how it is for people. Someone wrote me a message on Twitter this week. Such is my life. And this person who wrote me very kindly said that she'd been encouraged by a sermon she'd been listening to in Isaiah 52. And that the sermon had made her think of these lyrics. While Satan weaves his shallow lies, God speaks to me in love, reminding me his only son has bought me with his blood. And I can think of no better place for us to stop this evening than to think of our Savior Jesus, to follow the tracks of the flock, to go along with the people of God where they've always gone, to go down to those green pastures where his word is, manna to our souls, to come to the place where wherever we go in Holy Scripture, we find Jesus, as we're doing here. And in finding Jesus, nourish ourselves in him. Well, Father, I pray that this evening, as we've meditated just for a few minutes on this great passage and been reminded that we live in the tension between how we look, how we appear, the imperfection and incompleteness of our lives now as Christians, looking like everybody else, looking a bit rough, really, spiritually speaking, but that inside, by the grace of God, there's something lovely, there's something beautiful, there's something that has begun in us that one day will manifest itself even in our outward appearance, in that spiritual and glorified body we shall have when Jesus comes again. We pray, Lord, that we would rest in those promises and that we would hunger and thirst after righteousness and come and feed from your word. Be near to us, we pray, in Jesus' strong name. Amen. Now may grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen.